Professor Norina Hertz, welcome to the show. I wonder, when you decided to write a book about loneliness, was that based on personal experience, or where did it start?
It did actually start with personal experience. I was teaching at university, and I noticed that my students were coming into my office and confiding in me that they felt really lonely and isolated. And I'd been teaching for quite a few years, and this was a new phenomenon. And it wasn't just that they were telling me that they felt lonely and isolated. It was also that I was observing that when I set them assignments, like group assignments, they were finding it really quite hard often to interact very well face-to-face. Because they spend so much time on their screens. And I actually raised this with a colleague, with the president of one of America's most prestigious universities, and he said to me he had seen exactly the same thing going on there. And in fact, it was so bad there that they were having to run how to read a face in real life classes for their incoming students, seriously. So for the incoming students, you know, they needed to teach them that if you're face-to-face in a room with somebody and they smile, that means it's all going really well. And if you frown, if somebody's frowning, that means it's going badly, because so many were arriving with such bad in-person skills.
And this was before before COVID, and you've been working on this book for a couple of years. What would you say has been the most surprising discovery for you traveling the world looking for things to write about in this book?
One maybe that comes to mind that is quite moving comes from Japan, where it turns out that the fastest growing age group of people going to jail are pensioners. Pensioners intentionally committing crimes, relatively minor crimes like shoplifting, because they're so lonely and they want the company and affection that they can find within jail. And researchers in Japan who've researched this phenomenon, you know, have many quotes of elderly people saying things like, "For me, jail was an oasis. It was the place where I could find company." And when they looked at who the people who were these elderly people going to jail were, half of them hadn't spoken to family for over a year, and most of them lived on their own.
And the thing is that it's bad for mental health to be lonely, too lonely.
But
most people know that. But it's also, it affects your physical health.
What happens is when we're lonely, we go into fight or flight mode, because we're actually creatures of togetherness. We're hardwired to connect. So evolutionarily, we were designed not to be lonely. So when we're lonely, our bodies do everything they can to tell us, stop, stop, stop being lonely. So our blood pressure goes up, our stress levels go up, our ability to fight infection goes down, our inflammation markers go up, and all of these things telling us, you know, stop being lonely, go and find a pack of people to be with. And what that does to our body when this is repeated over time is it obviously has a very bad effect on our health. In fact, loneliness is as bad for our health as smoking 15 cigarettes a day. It's also as bad for our health. We have a 30% higher risk of heart disease and a 40% higher risk of getting dementia if we're lonely. So it's really bad for our physical health as well. And yet we don't talk about it as a public health problem in this way.
Is it also a problem that we don't go to the stores so often? We get deliveries. We change society in that way. Or is this a problem concerning friends and family and those meetings?
The trouble is those very small micro exchanges, the hello to the cafe guy, or the browsing in your bookshop and chatting to the bookseller, all those small micro exchanges we have are actually really important to making us feel connected to others, happier and less lonely.
I wonder, Eric, how is it in the world of football? I'm thinking about young players that comes to Sweden or Iceland, and they know nobody, and they supposed to find a new life in this country, and even become football stars. Have you seen loneliness among them?
Yeah, of course. This is important. For example, when I was a coach in Örgryte in Gothenburg, we took some Brazilian players, and if you take a Brazilian player and put him in a hotel, for example, he's not feeling well. He needs the people around and talks, and so it's really important. And I have to say, my club there was really good to get Brazilian people in Gothenburg and helping those people so they feel they are not feeling lonely, because if you want to be good, if you want to be playing good and so on, you need to feel good.
Norina,
I was going to say, yes, I was thinking when you were speaking, Eric, about you know, earlier in my career, I worked in Russia, and really far away from anyone who I knew. And I remember feeling that was probably the time in my life when I felt most lonely, because I was really far away from anyone I knew. It was in the days when you were in Russia, if I wanted to phone England, I had to place my call 24 hours in advance, and it took 24 hours to get it. And I was in this factory in the middle of nowhere eating kasha, buckwheat, meal after meal, and I felt really lonely. So I feel for your players, and I'm so glad that you like think about this so hard and recognize it and do something about it.
But Eric, there must be sometimes lonely at the top as well, as the manager.
Oh yeah.
Do you have a memory of that?
Yeah, I have many memories of that, of course. But the most lonely part I've had, that was in South Africa. I was there for working before the Iceland work, and this was 2018. My wife was in Gothenburg. I was living in Johannesburg, and in the summer here, it's the winter there, and it was quite cold in the evenings and nights, and it was really cold in my apartment. I had problem with my ischias nerve, and I was sitting there with freezing and so on, and then I was talking to my wife, and they were a fantastic summer that summer in Sweden, and they were out sitting with her friends and family and so on, and I was sitting there in South Africa and felt really lonely, I have to say. But that's the... But also you feel lonely, of course, as a coach also, especially when you lose. If you win, you have a lot of SMS in your phone. If you lose, you have.
It's so quiet, isn't it?
Yeah, I have three from my wife and my two daughters.
How about you, Norina? What's your first memory of feeling lonely?
I think it was when I was about 8 years old, in the playground at my primary school. And there was a girl, Deborah Putz, who made sure that the other kids didn't ask me to play hopscotch and play skipping. And I felt very lonely. And that was the year that I actually, in this connection with our physical health, it was the year that I had repeated sore throats and kind of repeated colds.
You did, during your work, discover a whole new business, which I was not aware of, and obviously Eric Hamrén was not aware of it when he was in South Africa, and that is that you can actually buy a friend.
Rent.
Buy a company.
Rent, not buy.
Rent, yes. Rent. Yeah, you can just rent it. You can't buy it and then keep it.
Maybe if you've got a lot of money, you can buy it. But yeah, you can rent a friend. And I actually tried this out in New York. So I went on a website where you can rent a friend. I was a bit worried, I have to admit, thinking maybe rent a friend is something a bit more than friend. But actually, it really isn't. It's a platonic friend who you're renting. And I rented a young woman, Brittany. I arranged to meet her at a cafe. We went and we drank lattes together in a cafe. Then we walked around Manhattan. We walked into a bookshop. We walked into a clothes shop. We tried on hats. We tried on sunglasses. We chatted about our relationships, about Me Too, about Ruth Bader Ginsburg at the time we were talking about. And it was actually fun. And there were kind of... There was a lot of these 3 hours when I really forgot that I was paying for her. But then I was brought down to earth very clearly because at the end of our 3 hours, we're in the clothes shop, we've just had our hats on, and she turns around and she says, time's up, three hours is up, that's $120, please.
but this is amazing. How big is this industry? How do you know that?
Yeah, 620,000 friends to rent. But when I asked her who are the main people who rent her services, she said women and men aged between 30 and 40, professionals, people who are working really long hours, have moved to Manhattan and don't have the time to invest in making real friends. So they get to the weekend or they get to the end of a long day at work and they're just lonely and they want someone to hang out with or go to a movie with. So it's quite an extreme case, but it speaks to this, it points to a much bigger problem because the figures are quite astounding. In the United Kingdom, 1 in 5 Brits are lonely most or all of the time. And 1 in 8 Brits say that they don't have a single friend that they could rely on. And I looked to see if it was markedly different in Sweden and Finland and Norway, but actually it's not. I mean, slightly better, but not much better.
What should we do about this? I mean, apart from the obvious things.
Yeah, there's so much that can be done. There's a lot that governments could do. Social media, I really believe, is the tobacco industry of the 21st century, and it should be regulated as such, especially when it comes to children. I really do believe that addictive social media for children should be banned as a starting point. I think the infrastructure of community that we've seen ravaged across the globe over the past few years, really since the financial crisis, but beyond, libraries, youth clubs, elderly care centres. Governments need to reinvest in that because people need places where they can physically come together.
Thank you so much, Noreen Hurst. Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.